Hachette Audio presents This Is Big, How the Founder of Weight Watchers Changed the World and Me, written and read by Marisa Meltzer. Author's note. I wish that I had gotten a chance to meet Jean Nidetch. Her slim autobiography, The Jean Nidetch Story, was a starting point and an introduction to her inimitable voice. Luckily, Jean had been enough of a media star in her day that she'd left interviews, profiles, and television appearances to review and to quote from. I talked to people who knew Jean both personally and professionally, plus I spoke with historians, critics, and writers of her era and ours. I read issues of Weight Watchers magazine in sequence, spent days reading vintage cookbooks, made my way through archives and bid on Jean-related memorabilia, including handwritten cards and a vinyl recording of her advice on eBay. I found as much information as I could about her and drew my conclusions about her life from that research. Some of Jean's many colorful anecdotes proved to be inaccurate or conflicting, whether because she was a fabulist or maybe because she just didn't have the best memory. For example, she told the story of the woman in the grocery store mistaking her for pregnant many times. Sometimes it took place in September, sometimes October. In her autobiography, which she wrote in her mid-80s, she recalled the Jessica Mitford article coming out in the early 1980s. I found it in Mitford's own archive. It was published in 1967. I never did find where she originally said, "It's choice, not chance, that determines your destiny." If I could verify a story from outside accounts, I did. Otherwise, I went with the version that seemed the most accurate from my research. I was not reporting this book undercover. The company knew I was working on a book about Weight Watchers and cooperated with my research, as did group leaders and some members. But everyone deserves privacy, especially in the ups and downs of dieting, so I have changed several names, and some characters in the book are composites. A few passages have appeared previously in other publications, and timelines have been condensed or shifted. Prologue. It's choice, not chance, that determines your destiny. Jean Nidetch. Jean Nidetch woke up one morning in September 1961 feeling sylph-like. "Did you know you could weigh 214 pounds and have a thin day?" she would later ask crowds who came to see her speak. She put on a muumuu, a dress she considered a fat woman's boon because it hung nicely over everything and in the pocket she could squirrel away pistachios. The tag on the dress read size 10. In reality, Jean wore a size 44, roughly equivalent to a 20 in modern vanity sizing, but she'd had a seamstress remove the tags from her clothing and replace them with smaller, more cheering sizes. Her driver's license weight was 145 pounds, which she hadn't been since high school, but nobody weighed you at the DMV. Jean tied a ribbon in her hair. She walked through Little Neck to the supermarket where she passed rows of crisp cereal and stocked up on graham crackers for her young sons. She lingered in the sweets aisle, filling her cart with bright yellow boxes of the delicious, pillowy, chocolate-covered marshmallow cookies called Malamars. These were what she called her Frankenstein, a favorite treat and nemesis and the real reason she'd come to the store. She'd taken to hiding them in the hamper in her bathroom. She would sneak in, lock the door, and consume three satisfying boxes at a time. She tried to make a joke out of it. One cookie plus one cookie equals 11. Afterward, she always promised herself she'd quit Malamars, but her resolve never lasted more than a few days. That September morning, Jean found herself back at the supermarket, stocking up once again. She would simply tell the checker the boxes of cookies were for her children. It was a cycle that she thought she'd never break. Being fat was just unlucky, and despite that, Jean felt like she had done well. She was 38 years old, happily married to a nice husband who drove a bus and who was fatter than she was, which meant she could still feel small and ladylike. She had two healthy sons, ages 5 and 10. What more could Jean Nidetch of Queens, New York in 1961 reasonably ask for? Then Jean spotted a woman she'd met on occasion in the neighborhood, standing over by the cantaloupes. She hadn't especially liked her when they'd been introduced, but Jean was a good housewife and a purposefully outgoing person. She figured that if she was going to be fat, at least she had to be friendly to make up for it. "Jean, you look so wonderful," the woman told her. "Did you have a good summer?" Jean, flattered, answered that she had. She thought not of sun and sand, but of the concession trucks that made their way along the streets of Little Neck, selling ice cream, donuts, pizza, and sandwiches. Trucks that she'd run to catch up to, something only kids were supposed to do. "You look so marvelous," the woman said again, looking her up and down. "What do you do?" To say that it was a moment that she would never forget is an understatement. It would define and transform the rest of her life. But at the time, Jean, the ultimate chatterbox, was dumbstruck. That woman thought she was pregnant. Eventually, Jean stammered something about how she had to go and made her way home in a hasty retreat. "What do I do now?" she kept asking herself as she walked the four blocks home. When she made it back, she stood in front of the full-length mirror behind her bedroom door. It was something she normally tried to avoid. Jean was fine with her reflection in the bathroom mirror. The face, the lipstick, and the hair she could get just right. She'd walk away thinking her eyes were gorgeous. This time, though, she looked hard at her hips and stomach. Bulges. Who was she to be having a thin day? Later, Jean would write, "Most fat people need to be hurt in some way in order to be jolted into taking action and doing something for themselves. Something has got to happen to demoralize you suddenly and completely before you see the light." She decided right there in front of the full-length mirror to be grateful to the woman at the supermarket, not because she liked her or would forgive her, but because she'd given Jean what she needed. This is big. Introduction. Jean Nidetch is dead. I have the slightly morbid habit of reading the New York Times obituary section every morning, usually while sitting at the kitchen table in my Brooklyn apartment, drinking coffee, while my bulldog, Joan, snores at my feet, exhausted from her 20 minutes of walking. An obituary takes someone's life and compresses it into a neat arc of beginnings, highlights, lowlights, and endings, which is why I enjoy reading them before I go off and make my way through my own work as a writer as well as my life, in both of which I often feel like I'm traveling from one slippery point to an unknown other, lacking coherence or a plan. In obituaries, I have a subconscious wish to see in one illuminating flash how another person figured out her story so I can gain some insight into mine. It was mostly a soothing habit until the morning I read about Jean. In late April 2015, the obit headline read, "Jean Nidetch, a founder of Weight Watchers, dies at 91. I must have looked confused. It had not ever occurred to me that an actual person had thought up Weight Watchers. To me, at 38 years old, the ubiquitous weight loss company had no origin story. It had always just existed. Existed, I thought, to torment me. Tortured would be a polite way to label my relationship to dieting, which I had pursued my whole life. I can't even recall how old I was when my parents put me on my first diet. 4? 5? I think I was 9 when they signed me up for Weight Watchers. That was what passed for smart parenting in the 1980s. Weight Watchers didn't last more than a few weeks, and it didn't work. None of the diets ever did. They still don't. I am a chronic, classic yo-yo dieter whose weight has risen and fallen so many times that, if charted, it would resemble a city skyline. But there was Jean Nidetch smiling at me from the homepage of the New York Times with big owl-like glasses and a blonde bouffant, holding a piece of cake she clearly had no intention of eating. My first thought was that finally I had a face to put to my misery. I read Jean's obituary, eager to give myself a target to blame for my own Sisyphean attempts at dieting and all the attendant obsession and frustration. I thought I knew just what the story of her life would be. Some variation of a thin woman becomes rich and famous, butting into overweight people's lives, never giving them a moment's respite from calorie counting or branded no-fat frozen treats. But as I read, I didn't see a villain in Jean Nidetch. I saw myself. Here was a woman who also had spent a lifetime thinking about her weight. Jean had been a chubby kid who turned into a fat adult, a woman who wrestled with a raging sweet tooth and whose preferred method of consumption was not enjoying a slice of fancy cake with friends, but rather inhaling an entire package of her favorite supermarket cookies in the privacy of her own bathroom. Jean and I were both 5'7", Jewish, blonde, hers by bottle, mine by birth, and residents of Brooklyn, hers by birth, mine by adoption. When I look at old photos of her before she lost the weight, the physical resemblance between us is so strong she could easily be my aunt or cousin. She could almost be me, somehow transported back in time to New York City in 1961. I realized that I was the same age as Jean was when she'd begun to lose weight and transform her life beyond her own and anyone else's wildest expectations. Her rock-bottom moment was when someone mistakenly assumed she was pregnant. Dozens of people have mistakenly assumed I was pregnant. At the airport, on the subway, at restaurants as I sat next to my own thin mother. One woman at the department store Barney's wouldn't even take no for an answer. "You must be at least postpartum," she said and stared at my abdomen. I blushed, shook my head, and tried to look busy browsing scarves. I made a mental note never to wear that gray hoodie I had on again. Jean also sounded so human, a woman who'd struggled with love and age and work and family and her place in the world. So instead of delighting in the demise of a newfound nemesis, by the time I finished reading the abbreviated version of Jean Nidetch's life, I felt a moment of connection between us. My job as a journalist who writes a lot about the world of beauty and wellness and fitness entails sampling treatments and sometimes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.